This is my 3x3x4. As you can see, it's horrendous quality. This was my first attempt at making a cuboid, and it actually does work. I think this is probably the first custom-made cuboid in the world. There was a mass-produced one, the Rubik's Domino, which is a 2x3x3, but nothing else had been made, I don't think, anywhere. I used a Rubik's Revenge puzzle, or Master Cube, and just glued bits to the outside of it. I later discovered that you could actually cut down like the inner 4x4 to make cuboids a lot smaller, but it barely sort of works. This is probably the puzzle I'm most well known for. It's my golden cube. I've done loads of videos on it. It's incredibly good movement, and I've always liked it. I had the idea in 1999. I was going to call it the Millennium Cube, but I didn't finish it in time, so I ended up just calling it the Golden Cube. But I think it's quite a nice puzzle, and of course it uses a scoop mechanism, and then I've cast polyester resin pieces and added them to the outside, because my later puzzles I'm using polyurethane resin. This is a Siamese 5x5s. At the time, the only ones available were the Professor Cube, or the also known as the Rubik's WAN. So the quality again is not fantastic. And it was quite a difficult puzzle actually to make, because when you start sort of gluing pieces together like that in the middle, it really affects the movement. So I had to do a lot of sort of sanding. But it's not bad though, sticker missing there. This is my icosahedron mega minx. I had this idea like when I first saw the mega minxes, but I think somebody else had built one first, so I can't really take much credit for this. It's just a basic transformation of a mega minx, turning it into an icosahedron from a dodecahedron. Actually, the movement works quite well. The colouring's gone a little bit dodgy over the years. This is my giant container puzzle. I made about three of these, and they were later mass produced. Now, the idea was comes from Jean-Claude Constantine, and he sort of allowed me to sell them and also mass produce them with Calvin. The puzzle again is based on a scoop mechanism, as a lot of my early ones were. And later I discovered that you can sort of cut the scoop down a bit and make them a lot smaller. But I was just sort of learning. I think this has been re-stickered because it looks pretty good, whereas it's so old, I mean, by now it should be looking terrible. So I reckon I probably re-stickered it a few years ago. This is my 3x4x4, another one of my early cuboids. And it's very similar to the 3x3x4 in that I just added bits on top of a 4x4 Rubik's Revenge. It's a little bit better quality, but it's still incredibly heavy, and movement is pretty awful. Again, I'm wondering whether I re-stickered it, because I think those stickers look sort of nice and clean, and I would have thought by now they would have been sort of falling off. But I say once again, one of the world's first custom-made cuboid puzzles. And another cuboid puzzle, 2x2x4, getting a little bit tatty. Movement's not bad. This isn't much later. People had made these along before me. I think it feels like it's made from an niche scene, so I'm guessing it's made from a niche scene. 4x4, probably a 4x4 EC. It does go into kind of weird shapes, whereas the last two cupolas I've showed you don't. They retain their shapes. What else have we got? This is a rhombic dodecahedron transformation of a scoob. So again, the movement's nice. Started to look a bit tatty. I think I was the first ever to make these, and then of course Uwe Meffert later mass produced them and called them the scoob kite. But this has always been one of my favourite sort of shapes, and this was quite a nice puzzle. This, the blue's like a weird sort of textured blue. I don't think I could find a better blue. I mean, in those days before I was on the internet, you just had to go to like hardware stores, and that's the only place I could sort of buy stuff. So if they didn't have the colours I wanted, I couldn't get them. And I could never find orange. It wasn't until I started to go to Holland, and where they love orange, I could never find an orange colour. Now, the remains of a Fisher coop. Possibly this is the first one I ever made. I'm not sure. As you can see, it's horrendous quality and all fallen apart. But I mean, I don't really want to clean it up. It's kind of, I don't know, it's almost sort of historic. It's, if I cleaned it up and re-stickered it, then it would kind of take away its charm, I guess you'd say. Three by three barrel. Not quite as old as some of the others. Quite an easy sort of puzzle to solve. It does shape shift. It's getting a little bit tatty. This is a tetrahedron made from a scoob. This is actually written about in, I think, 1992, though it wasn't mass produced until very recently. In fact, I'm not even sure whether it has even been mass produced, because I think there's like been kind of pillowed versions of them. I think Jing's Pyraminx, but I'm not sure whether there's actually been a flat-sided one. I was probably the first one to actually make one. I'm not sure whether I just got the idea from that article in 1982 or whether I actually kind of thought of it independently myself. But either way, it doesn't really matter. And I've managed to mess it up. Right, so this is a very, very early one. I think I made this in 1989. It's just like a rhombus prism from a 3x3. Quality's pretty awful. I didn't use a genuine Rubik's cube, so it's not that great. I think I possibly saw, I think I might have seen this in a drawing of this in a catalogue by Jean-Claude Constantine. Because what he did, he kind of just made like this catalogue with ideas, and most of them hadn't actually been made. So I think I just copied it from him. I never made any more. I don't think they were mass produced. Yeah. This is a combined scoob and octahedron, a fairly simple transformation. I'd just taken the squares of a scoob and then made them up into little pyramids. So you've got the octahedron inside. So I'm now touching the corners of the octahedron, and then you've got the sort of scoob as well, kind of thing, which I'm now touching the corners of the scoob. Kind of a fairly simple idea. An icosahedron transformation of a scoob with a sticker coming off. This was one of the hardest puzzles to make. At the time, you know, without the 3D printing, and everything had to sort of be done by hand. So I hand sculpted the masters and then cast them in polyester resin. The quality is still not bad, really, considering how old it is. I then later went on to make much better quality ones. I still actually sell those on eBay sometimes. But this isn't too bad for a prototype that old. This is a newer 3x3x4. If you just go back to the original one, you can see how much smaller it is. I think this was made from an Eastsheen 4x4, cut down. And you can see the movement is really, really quite nice. Now with this one and some of the other cuboids I've made later, it's actually made with plastic sheet, so I wasn't casting it, so the weight is a lot better. But I still really I quite like that. Obviously there's been various sort of versions mass produced. It doesn't change its shape, as I mentioned earlier. And then there's a 2x3x4 cuboid. I think this was the first time anyone ever made one. And again, made from an Eastsheen, heavily cut down. Because you see the thickness is only slightly thicker than an Eastsheen, so you can imagine how kind of cut down it all has to be. Works pretty well. Every move, I think, is like a double. It's almost like a two. Everything has to go twice, because if you do it 90 degrees, you can't do anything else. Nothing else moves. So it's kind of restrictive, and you've only got like the two colours that can appear on any side. If that makes sense. This is my Hexaminx. Another incredibly difficult puzzle to make, doing it all by hand, you know, casting it and everything, without any 3D printing. This one's actually coloured with original Method Scoop stickers. I got the material and cut them out myself. It's a nice puzzle, though. I mean, it's not great fun to play with, because you have to sort of line everything up absolutely perfectly, and it does shape shift, so you just end up with a complete kind of muddle. So although I like the thing and I'm proud of it, it's certainly not one of my favourite to play with. Siamese Scoops. You might actually think these would be really easy to make, but they're not. It's difficult to join them together so they still move, because you've got to kind of like join the two cores together without affecting the movement. So actually it's a tricky little puzzle. I was quite sort of like that, fairly simple. And probably the world's first dodecahedron transformation of a scoob. It obviously later became well known as the Scoob Ultimate, but I think this is the first ever one. I'd certainly seen pictures of this, like drawings and stuff, early on. I forget where it might even have been. Might even be David Singmaster, I'm not sure. It probably needs re-stickering, because it's a bit sort of tacky. But certainly one of my early ones. And these ones were good enough to sell, so that kind of pushed me into sort of the selling business as well. Whereas, you know, when you're making stuff like that, you really, I must admit, I did sell one of these, but you're not really going to be able to sell many of them. Whereas then when you start getting things better quality, then you can start thinking, well, hang on a minute, maybe I can make a business out of this. Maybe I can do this for the rest of my life instead of proper work. Right, talking about poor quality puzzles, this is pretty horrendous. It's a tetrahedron transformation of a 3x3. I really had no idea how to do it, so I pretty much just built onto a 3x3. I think there's a lot better ways of doing it than this, and it's pretty horrendous quality. But it's one of those sort of learning stages, you know, you sort of, some things come out well, some things don't, and you just go on and do sort of better things later. It actually moves surprisingly well. It's incredibly heavy, it's all solid, there's no hollowness to it at all. This was sort of much later than the 3x3x4. This had been made by several people. Again, I'd used an Eastsheen I'm assuming it must be an Eastern 5x5. A lot of people made them by extending 3x3s. Actually, the puzzle I'll show you in a minute. So this is a cross cubes, and this is made by extending a lot of 3x3 on each face. So people made the 5x5 that way to get it smaller. But I thought my way was better because you get much better quality and it's really smooth, even though it's a little bit bigger. But the cross cube kind of looks nice, but it's horrendous quality again. And this has certainly like been mass produced much later on. The hours these sort of things take to make, casting all the pieces and sort of hacking away at the 3x3 so it will actually work. I don't know if I could be bothered nowadays, because all those hours work and you sort of achieve something that's not even that great. This is a later one, a truncated skewed kite. So it's essentially one of those truncated, but I did use the mass produced version, so its quality is a lot nicer and its stickers are quite clean, so I think that's pretty good quality. It's my overlapping cube, another one of my favourites. Made from an Eastern 4x4 because it has kind of like internal bits that I've extended to the surface, so the movement is really nice, but it has this kind of weird overlapping quality to it, and it doesn't move. It's really difficult to explain how it moves because it's got an internal block that kind of restricts certain movements, so I can't move it through there unless I actually turn it like around, and then I can, but then I can't move it through there. So the whole thing can be scrambled, but only some moves are available some of the time. And it wasn't really my intention to do it like that. It's just how the 5x5, sorry, the Eastern 4x4 works. It has that internal kind of blocking to stop internal pieces getting out of alignment, which was a big issue on the VQ6. So it's all kind of to do with alignment and stuff. But I think that turned out really well. I like that. And I thought a later variation of that, of course, was my ball and a cube. So I just ended up shaping those pieces like a ball. And so it's got exactly the same, it's got like the same sort of movement and the same way that can't be, you can't separate those two unless you've got to move it around to somewhere else and then you can. So it's the solving is pretty much the same. And some people think that I should have matched the colours, you know, like white, but I think it looks far better like this with the colours kind of contrasting. So it looks like a ball and a cube. It's not just like bland sort of colours on each side. Another 2x2, I already showed you one of them. Now, this is a really early one. I just had the idea to paint a Rubik's cube with luminous paint, and as you can see, it looks pretty horrendous in the light, but in the dark it's slightly less horrendous. Three by three bandage cube with stickers kind of coming off. I was never really interested in bandage cubes, but people sort of asked me to make them and they were discussed a lot, and so I thought I'd better at least make one. I think a lot of these have sort of been mass produced. Not sure whether this exact design has, but it probably has. This is a 5x5 rhombic dodecahedron with stickers coming off, made from an Eastern 5x5, so the movement is super smooth. Because I like the Eastern 5x5s because you could do what you like with them and the movement would remain sort of smooth. You could really sort of cut them down, But because the only thing with each scene 5x5 is there's no sort of corner cutting. So, but at the time I only had, you know, originally I only had like the Rubik's 5x5s, the 4x4s, and then the Ishin ones came out. And for a long while, that was it. You know, there was none of the modern ones you get nowadays. So, so I only moved on the 5 layers. You can't like move that bit there. So, but I think it was quite a nice puzzle. It's quite popular. So this is a slightly more modern version of the tetrahedron. So this was made out of plastic sheet rather than casting a piece out of resin. So it's lighter and the movement's much better. That is an improvement. I mean, a lot of these I would sort of call prototypes, and then maybe we'll have a second prototype, and then maybe I'll make a few to sell. It's, you know, it's kind of like how it sort of works. Siamese cubes. Now, I don't know whether this was the first one, possibly. If it was the first one I made, then this is the first, probably the first puzzle transformation in the world. Well, that's what I like to claim anyway, because I haven't found anybody that made anything earlier than me. Well, I just had the idea. I love the Rubik's Cube. I was obsessed with them, and there wasn't many coming out, you know, new things coming out, and I just thought, right, I'm going to start making my own. And this seemed like an obvious thing to do, because you can't move pieces across from one cube to another, but I still think it's quite good. And it doesn't need a slight variation on how you solve it, because it's like the equivalent of a 3x3 with a kind of a bandaged 1x1x3 block in the middle. It's my truncated Octomink. This is my truncated Octomink. Just a little simple puzzle. Because the Octomink was a puzzle that was quite popular, and that in turn was a transformation of a mass-produced Tetramink. So nothing special there. I used method styler stickers on that, the textured ones. Getting a little bit tatty. This is my first mental block puzzle. Again, I'd sort of call it a prototype, I suppose. Quality is not too bad, but it's really heavy. It's all solid pieces. Again, as you can sort of hear, it's scoop mechanism. So I'm casting pieces in polyester resin and attaching them to the outside. I later, much later, made another one that was made with like plastic sheet. So again, it's got a scoop mechanism in there, but it's made of plastic sheet. So it doesn't look that much different, but it is a bit tidier and an awful lot lighter. It's much sort of more professionally made, I would say. So, and I was able to sell quite a few of these. It's quite a nice puzzle. It takes a long while to make, because you have to make each piece sort of individually. You're not just casting them, you're actually building them up with little squares of, well, little shapes of plastic sheet and sort of gluing it all together. So it's quite time consuming. Hexagonal prism, again, scoop mechanism in there. A really quite nice puzzle, this, I think. Pretty sure it was my idea and sort of first one ever made. Don't think they were ever mass produced, which is a little bit weird, I guess. But yeah, I quite like that. It's always, I quite like hexagons, and I think it's quite nice. Octahedron, I probably should have shown this earlier before I showed the combination, because that's a very early transformation of a scoop. I don't think it was my idea. I think I'd seen it somewhere else, but I think I was the first one to actually make it. But again, this was solid plastic, so it's very heavy, cast of polyester resin. And later I went on to make better quality ones, and Uwe Meffert eventually mass produced them as a scoop diamond. Another 3x3x5, which I showed earlier. Now this is a Pyraminx Ultimate. Now, this was copied directly from Meffert's catalogue. He also, like Jean-Claude Constantine and a few others, had a catalogue where there was puzzles that were just sort of like drawings and mock-ups that had never been made, and they were just ideas. And this was one of them. And the movement is quite horrendous. If I recall correctly, I made it like the cross cube, but and then cut it down. So it's a nice looking puzzle, but it does fall apart very easily. So I could never like sell a thing or anything. Again, I just kind of call it a prototype. I think other people have now gone on and made them like CAD and whatever. So it's not it's certainly not the only one in the world. My bicone, another skew transformation. Certainly not the best transformation in the world, sculpturing it all by hand. Well, sculpturing the masters by hand to make the molds was very difficult. As you can imagine, that shape is sort of horrendous to do by hand. So it works. I've sold a few like on eBay, but it's not fantastic quality. Pretty sure it's never been mass produced. Stickers are horrendous to cut the right shape and stick them on, because you know it's like a curved surface and they just don't want to stick. But that was not too bad though. My first 5x5 egg puzzle, that's a little bit scrambled. Just a transformation of a V-cube 5, I think I used for that. I did then go on and make some in black plastic, like with gold and silver stickers. But this was like my first sort of prototype for them, so quality's not too bad. My 7x7 barrel, for some reason there's no stickers on that side, I'm not quite sure why. Again, I'd sort of call this a prototype, the first one I ever made, and then as you can see it's scrambled and I couldn't really be bothered to solve it because it would be pretty time consuming. And it does move if you move if line everything up. Again, well, made with a V-cube 7, so I mean I sort of like the quality of a V-cube 7, but possibly for something like this a lot of knockoff cube would have been better quality, but I don't really want to use knockoff cubes, so I'm kind of stuck with the V-cube 7s. I would show you one solved, but I think this is the only one I have now. This is my Kubo Minx, made from a Tetra Minx. Obviously a cube version of a Tetra Minx. I really had no idea how to make it because the corners want to sort of clash. So I there's like really thin pieces of plastic. So again, it's a definite sort of prototype and I never went anywhere with it. I didn't really know what to do with it or how to improve it, so it's just another kind of idea that pretty much got abandoned. You know, I made probably one video and that was the end of it. Another 2x3x4 puzzle, exactly the same as the one I showed you earlier. So this is a truncated cube octahedron. It's a 5x5, a Rubik's 5x5, Rubik's WAN, Professor Cube, whatever you want to call it. And I just cut it down. And it's sort of weird because I cut it really into sort of the mechanism. I mean, it still works just with stickers falling off. But I never expected to see these sort of weird patterns. So really I've kind of cut it down to the absolute limit of working to the sort of the point where it barely works, if that makes sense. And all these sort of weird sort of lines, as I say, are sort of into the core pretty much. And I think later this sort of pattern was known as Olsen, because it's a way a puzzle designer started to make like cuboids and stuff. But I'll go into that in another video. Another horrendous luminous cube, little mini one. I think he dates back to 1987, something like that. Just really an experiment. So this is a dino trunk with dinosaur stickers. Now I call it dino trunk because it looks like a truncated dino cube. But at the time when I made this, dino cubes were incredibly rare and incredibly expensive. So I actually made it from a rainbow cube. But I copied the dinosaur pictures, so it's got the exact same ones on it as you had on some of the original dino cubes. Movement is pretty good. I mean, whatever you do with rainbow cubes, the movement stays pretty good. So they're a nice little puzzle to use for transformations. You can do sort of a lot with them. This is my 4x4x6, the world's first 4x4x6 cuboid. And like so many others, the quality is absolutely horrendous. Now, what I actually did was I took a 4x4 Rubik's Revenge and I extended it in the same way as I did for the cross cube. But because you've got more pieces to extend, so it's more things that can go wrong. So it really is a horrendous puzzle. But I just like the idea of like being the first to make something. So I was prepared to sort of put up with very sort of poor quality to get these things done. And as I said before, you kind of like learning, and you know, every time you make something, even if it's poor quality, you are actually sort of learning something. So next time it will be a bit better, or you'll sort of take a different direction. I think that's all I'm going to do with it, because it's liable to just fall apart at any minute. Now this is a master skew. Now at the time it was almost impossible for me to make something like this, and because I just didn't have the ability to like do the corners. So I made it from a face turn and octahedron, and although it works, actually it works not too bad. As I say, I had no way of doing the corners. I just didn't have a technical know-how. So the way I achieved the corners was magnets. And I think this is one of the first twisty puzzles to incorporate magnets. And now there's always like a bit of a taboo about magnets for some reason in twisty puzzles. People were kind of like shied away from having them. And I actually thought they were a really good idea, because if you're careful, you don't even notice that they exist. Now, I'm not saying necessarily you'd want a mass-produced puzzle with magnets. Obviously, like speed cubes and stuff, that's different. But to have a mass-produced puzzle where the parts are actually held in with magnets is probably not a good idea. So, yeah, that's my box of custom-made puzzles. And stay tuned for another box in another video.